Good morning. Welcome this morning. We're glad that you're here with us. It's good to see you. Good to be together in this place as we come to worship together. As we get started this morning, we encourage you all to sing out as we sing about being free. The grace of Jesus is free to us. Isn't that good news? Let's all stand together and sing.
There's a fountain free, 'tis for you and me. Let us haste, oh haste, to its spring. 'Tis a fount of love from the source above, and he bids us all freely drink. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me. Thirsty soul, hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain opened for all. There's a living stream with a crystal gleam. From the throne of life now it flows. While the waters roll, let the weary soul hear the call that forth freely goes. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come?
'Tis for you and me.
Thirsty soul, hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain open for all. There's a rock that's cleft, and no soul is left that may not its pure water share. 'Tis for you and me, and its stream I see. Let us hasten joyfully there. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me. Thirsty soul, hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain opened for all.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. Yet while I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Who
the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am in my Father's house. There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am in my Father's house. There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Would you bow with me? Dear God, very thankful to be here this morning, to be experiencing this beautiful weather, to be all here together with people we love, with our family. Pray that you will help us as we uplift one another through these songs we're singing, through the prayers that we have and the words we're going to listen to, and just through our fellowship. Dear God, we pray that the things that we do will glorify you, and then that we will continue to glorify you the rest of this week. We're so forever grateful for your Son, for your love for us, and your grace. And we pray this through him. Amen.
We're about to take of the Lord's Supper together. If you do not have your emblems, if you'll raise your hand during the singing of this next song, we'll bring those out to you.
We gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like living flame. For through the loving Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. No one is a stranger here. Everyone belongs. Finding our forgiveness here, we in turn forgive all wrongs. He joins us here. He breaks the bread. The Lord who pours the cup is risen from the dead. The one we love the most is now our gracious host. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. We are now a family of which the Lord is head. Though unseen, he meets us here in the breaking of the bread. We'll gather soon where angels sing. We'll see the glory of our Lord and coming King. Now we anticipate the feast for which we wait. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. Come take the bread, come drink the wine. Come share the Lord.
As we prepare for the Lord's Supper, I thought it might be good to just think about and imagine in our minds what it was like on that particular evening. It was just before the the Passover feast, as John records in John 13:1. I never got to go in that room when I was in Jerusalem, but it passed by and it said the upper room. And I wish the guide had stopped to let us look in. But I can imagine that it's a much smaller room than this. The light would have been low. Jesus and his 12 apostles were there. There was one loaf of bread. Sorry about that. There was one loaf of bread, much larger than these, and a cup of wine. I would imagine you're sitting close to someone that you feel closer to than all these other people in the room, even though we are a church family. I think that's the way Jesus felt. He had his brothers, his mother, but these 12 people had been with him pretty much day and night for 3 years. Just think about that. Jesus had just washed their feet, and I may come back to that in a minute if I remember it, but this very intimate setting is what we actually beg for with our own families, with those close to us. Let's pray. Father, as we partake of this bread, you ask us to eat it and to think of your son's body as he asked us to think of his body. He said, take this and eat it. He wanted to be in each one of us in a special way. And this physical way makes us think of that he wants to be in our lives inside and out, every day, every moment. Help us to take this bread as a memorial to him, that we might have a daily reminder of how much he loved us, just like he did his disciples. We thank you for this bread in Jesus' name. Amen. It's kind of interesting to me that just in moments before this, Jesus had removed his outer garment, wrapped it around his waist. It was long enough to be used as a towel, and he washed his disciples' feet. Now, Peter wasn't so big on that. Why? Because that's what slaves do. But he washed his feet. It's interesting that that word later appears when Ananias tells Paul, arise, be baptized, wash away your sins. It's the same form of that word, that we're being washed by the blood of Jesus. Let's pray. Father, your son Jesus told us that this fruit of the vine, this wine, represents his blood that cleanses us from all sins continually. Help us to take it now, keep that in mind, to know that you love us so much that you gave your son for us. And without a doubt, we should be thankful and praise your name and his name every day. Thank you in his name. Amen. I want to thank you for giving, and I've said it before. It's not just money, but it's time. A lot of people don't have much time from other people, but they need that time. You need to visit them, to spend time with them. Just listen and be there. Thank you so much for what you do.
Good morning. I'll try that again. We always do it twice. Good morning. It's all right. Yeah. Thank you for engaging. Good to see everybody. Got a good crowd. Got several people visiting with us. I say visiting with us. We got some people that I just haven't seen in a while that they're not really visitors. They're part of us. Rick and Cynthia back there and their family. It's good to see them. And just so y'all know, I don't know that I'm supposed to say this out loud, but I understand they put an offer in a house back here in Huntsville. Is that right? Yeah, we hope. I had to give you something to pray about. Pray that that goes through, all right? We're hoping that that will work for your family and you can get back to what we consider your home. The Durhams, I hadn't seen y'all in a while. Ada, hey Ada, hadn't seen you in a while. Yeah, all right, yep. We've been buddies back in class for a long time, but it's good to see y'all. And I know I miss people anytime I do it, but it's just good to see everybody. I want to give a few updates. And Greg, I hate to put you on the spot right here in front of everybody, but have you got your results? Okay, all right. Keep praying for Greg. I know it's always tough when we're waiting on outcomes for things, so I keep him in your prayers. Linda, she had her gallbladder surgery and is back home, so still recovery going on in her life and with her family, so keep them in mind. Steve is continuing to make small steps of improvement, right? And we're appreciative for that. I believe I saw, was it yesterday, I think you posted that it seemed like most of the conversation you were having with Steve, that it seemed like he was understanding you and responding back in some ways. And so that's good. It's good. Dorothy, she's gone back to the rehab facility, but with hospice. So when you say that, you know what that entails. It's just, Dorothy's lived a long and wonderful life, and we're hoping as she comes to the end of her life that that's peaceful for her and her family, and they can help with that. I think Jenny Gunnels, there you are. How's it back? There you go. It's okay as long as she's on drugs. Drugs are wonderful things, right? So still no update on being able to have the surgery. Did you get a shot in the back? Okay, get an injection this week, all right? And y'all know I've been struggling with some back pain, and like Jenny, and I'm trying to do some other things where I don't have to be on drugs, but if you have inflammation in your body, Mobic is a wonderful thing. And again, it's not that, like something we want to live our life with, but when it's there, it sure does help. I had a picture of Greg. So I was thinking of a couple other people. Alan Langford, he's at home not feeling well. Pam's at home not feeling well. Daniel Allen is just, it's tough in his body. So we want to pray for encouragement there. That's right. Mike's also at home not feeling well. Do what now? Diverticulitis, all right. So, yeah. I was talking to Phil and Nancy before. It's good to have them back. They've been, him, I think, first, and then Nancy, and then sort of together, and they've been through the road of COVID and the recovery from COVID, and talking to Nancy's oxygen's still not right at 100%, but it's a whole lot better than it used to be, right? And that's a wonderful thing. So, a lot of good news, and again, a lot of people are struggling and having a tough time. We'll pray, and then I'll mention a few other things, all right? Father, we just thank you so much for your love for us. We thank you for each person represented here today and those that are not able to be with us. And Father, just help us to really focus on you. And Father, as we talk a little bit later today about communing and worshiping you, but help us in those moments to realize that you do love us, you care for us, and you will provide. You'll provide sometimes healing, sometimes resources, sometimes you provide comfort and peace during difficult struggles. But whatever our need is, Father, you'll be there. We love you for that. Through Jesus we pray. Amen. All right, it's been mentioned, when we eat lunch, please clean your tables up. There's garbage cans around, sanitizing products around, so please use them. Things pop in my mind, and I just have to tell you. So I attended this week diversity training that really didn't appear to be diversified. It was more on, like, how to treat people, all right? I was telling some people, and so one of the things was, they said, like, we're going to present some scenarios, and one of the scenarios was your boss has called you in, you're having a performance discussion with your boss, and your cell phone rings, and you answer it. And the question was, in this scenario, okay, would that be courteous? And my response was, if we have somebody like that that's an employee, we hired the wrong person. It's like, that's something your daddy teaches me when you're 8 or 9 years old. I was just amazed that at my age, I'm sitting in a class, and I'll probably get fired for that, but that's all right. I'll just retire. All right. Well, I did have a slide that said we're having hot dogs and hamburgers. We took that out. That's actually sub sandwiches for lunch today because we're having a fish fry tonight. And you think, well, what do the two of those have to do together? Well, Danny and Tim were going to go on strike if they had to grill twice in one day. So we appreciate their work. Seriously, we do have the sandwiches for lunch, and we do have the fish fry. It's always a wonderful time at the fish fry. 5 o'clock, we'll be out at the pavilion, and we'll just hang out together. So plan to come to that. And so for the Durhams, I just have to say, Chrissy looked over and said, oh, I see the Durhams. They haven't been here in a while. She said, I bet they're here because we're having the fish fry tonight. Don't know. All right, this week some folks had fun. Some of the ladies, we've been mentioning, you know, the Heartfelt Friends, they've started back, and so I just had a few pictures. Here was a group that was at our house, and then I got a few pictures. Wait, this was at your house, right, Linda? So some of the ladies that were meeting there, just a lot of good things going on. Look for where you can plug in, fit in, participate, and encourage each other.
It's time for class for our toddlers up through the 8th grade, so we'll dismiss you, and then the rest of us, let's continue to worship in song. Let's stand up and sing out.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing love.
This is unfailing love.
That you would take my place.
That you would take my place.
That you would bear my cross.
That you would bear my cross.
You laid down your life.
You laid down your life.
That I would be set free.
That I would be set free.
Oh,
Jesus, I sing for
all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in
all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing love. Take my place.
That you would take my place.
That you would bear my cross.
That you would bear my cross.
You laid down your life.
You laid down your life.
That I would be set free.
That I would be set free.
Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing love.
This is unfailing love.
That you would take my place.
That you would take my place.
That you would bear my cross.
That you would bear my cross.
You laid down your life.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Be seated, please.
Good morning again. We'll continue in our series, and this series is what I've shared with you, is that for many years when I preach, I have either like had series, and so you had sequential lessons going through books of the Bible or any number of topics. And so you all always would begin the week, or I would, in preparation with that thought in mind, and then just look for things and read and study and prepare during the week to present that topic, all right? So based on some encouragement, I decided for a little while I would start the week with no thought. And I would just try to be with God and pray and ask, hey, during the week, as life happens, help me share with others what my experience was that week with God and see if that might be impactful. So I say all that to say, I was sitting with Christy Friday night, and she said, all right, so what we got Sunday? And I said, at this point, nothing. I said, me and God, we got nothing. So I got up yesterday and started, what are we going to do? And I picked up a book that I was given this week to read, and I started reading it. And it was very interesting. And we're just going to talk some. I'm going to talk through a few things. I'm going to have one point that I'm going to encourage you to do at the end, all right? We'll get there, but it may seem like we're rambling and just all over the place trying to go, all right? But when I started reading this book, at the very beginning, the question was asked, would you ask yourself, or when you read a book, and so you're getting ready to read this book, when you read a book, do you ever ask yourself, why am I reading this book? And then it lists a number of reasons why someone might read a book. And so as I'm reading this, I got to, sometimes I read a book. I don't know about you, but I want you to go there, all right, with me. Sometimes I read a book because I believe reading it, I'll learn some things that might help me in life, help me be better at something or just be a better person. You know, sometimes when I read a book, it's that way. I got to thinking about the most of the reading I do is work-related, and it's because I have to learn about something or need to know something or find out something. So a lot of times when I'm reading, it's not that I necessarily care about the information, but it's a necessary read, and you have to have it for the function of what you do. I got to think, when we go to the beach, and I've mentioned before, we like to sit on the beach. Christy really likes to sit on the beach, and I've learned to sit on the beach, and I shared that with y'all. I'm going to love it better next time. But so one of the ways I get through the day at the beach is by reading. And I'll read, like, stuff that you don't really have to pay attention to, John Patterson, Lee Child, you know, books like that. And, by the way, on books like that, if you sort of get bored with it but you want to get to the end, all you have to do is read the first sentence in any paragraph. And you can get through it a lot quicker. It will give you the facts. They state sort of the fact in the first sentence, and then they just make it more vivid for the rest of the paragraph. So anyway, you know, I'm just helping you. I'm full of help always, all right? But then it got down to the end of this question, and it said, sometimes you read a book because somebody either gave you a book or asked you to read a book, and you know you'll be asked about it later. And I thought, you know, when I opened this book up, that was really the main reason I started reading that book. I looked at it and I thought, I got nothing right now. Just let me just read something at random. But I really need to read this because when I see this person next time, they're going to ask me, hey, did you read any of the book? No, I don't want to lie about it. So anyway, all I'd say, most of you read the Bible or you get a daily Bible verse or, you know, something, right? Have you ever asked yourself, why do I read that? I ask you, I said I was going to give you an assignment at the end, so I'm actually giving you two. The first assignment is the next time you start to read anything from God, ask yourself that, why am I really reading this? I think a lot of times when we read anything from God, we're reading it because we believe that's expected behavior of someone that loves God. If you really answered honestly sometimes, that's why you're there. Is, you know, I've been taught, and rightfully so, that I should love the word that God has given me, so it's an obligation that I read it, and at this moment, that's why I'm there, is that's something I believe I'm supposed to do today. All right? And I've been there a lot. So now I try. And I was thinking about when I was reading that. When I read something from God now, I'm really doing my best to be wherever I am to, and I know we throw this word out, but I really want to know God. For most of my life, I spent most of my time learning a lot about God. I knew a lot about Him and about things that He had done and, you know, expectations of humans that He had created. I knew a lot about that, and I knew a lot about what He had written, but now I really just try to say, okay, in this moment, in whatever I'm looking at now, what does this tell me about You? See what I'm saying? What does it tell me about God? Because the more I know Your character and what You really are, the better I'm going to be able to relate with You and to You. So this takes me to a story. And so where we're going, we're going to talk about worship, all right? And I know when I say the word worship, I almost say we're going to talk about and come up with another name, because when you say the word worship, it's sort of like saying the word church or some other words. Everybody in their mind, in their own mind, when I use that word, automatically goes somewhere. So I ask you just to be open with the thought of worship, and let's see where we go as we talk about it. And the story we're going is very familiar. This is Jesus after John the Baptist. He's, you know, John's been baptizing, and he's started this movement that the political and religious leaders are paying a lot of attention to now, because it's creating a great interest and some turmoil and chaos. And now they've put John in prison, and then it's sort of now, okay, they're paying attention to Jesus and what he's doing, and Jesus is sort of weary, and he decides with his followers they're going to take a trip. And so they're down in Judea, and you know the story, and so they're going to go up to Galilee. But as they're traveling up to Galilee, they go through Samaria. And we know in our previous study that Samaritans and the Jews, Jesus, it's interesting because the Samaritans are, they follow a lot of the same teaching that Jesus and the Jewish would follow, but the Samaritans, they really pay attention only to like the first five books, the books of Moses. That's where they spend their time. And the biggest thing here, and you know in the story, is they have separated themselves in that now they have their own place of worship separate from where the Jewish temple is. They have their own temple, and they really, I know I get on tangents, you know, we think sometimes, and you watch the news, that like the hatred in the world right now is worse than it's ever been. Folks, the world has always been filled with hatred because it's always full of humans, all right? And I'm not saying it's not something that should be addressed and looked at. I'm just saying at this time, the Jews and Samaritans hated each other. I don't mean like they would just try to avoid each other. They hated each other, all right? So Jesus is making this trip. And he comes up to this well, as you know, and he's tired. This morning to the middle of the day, and his apostles, they've gone to get some food, and Jesus is resting at the well, and this lady comes up to him, and he asks her for a drink. And we're going to look at the scripture in just a second. Have you ever wondered, though, why did he ask her for a drink? Why didn't he get his own drink? Well, wells would not be exactly like this. There would be a well that was dug, and this was a well that Jacob had dug many, many years before. This isn't just a well. This well has significance. But when you go to the well at this time, now this is what's typically done, is you would take your own rope and your own bucket, and you would let it down into the well and draw it back up. All right? Now, you know, most time if you would see a well like this, there's either a pump or there's already something there. So most likely, Jesus had to ask her for a drink because he had no way of getting the water. He could look down, he could see the water, but he probably had no way of getting the water, which would make practical sense of why he would ask her, because she's come with a rope and with whatever it is that she's using to draw the water up to take back home, and he asked her for a drink. So when a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" Why is that? They hate each other, right? And also, it really wouldn't be appropriate that a man would be asking a woman for a drink in this culture and time and just the way things work. For Jews don't associate with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst." Y'all know this conversation, but when you read this conversation, sometimes you sort of get lost in, okay, what in here, what is, I hear a lot of talk about water, and I understand the living water and life, that God's going to give life, but really, what's the point in this discussion? "Well, indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." So he's having a very deep spiritual conversation with her. But the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He said, no. "Go back and call your husband and come back," he said. "I have no husband," she replied. And Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you've had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." Now, I want you to get this, right? So they're having this conversation, and John's telling us about the conversation. Don't get too wrapped up in all of the conversation. There's valuable things to learn there, but let's go on. "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors..." Now, this is where it gets sort of interesting, all right? She recognizes, okay, you're different than the normal guy. I mean, because you understood all this, you were all bringing us to light, you get all that, right? And then now she says, "Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and His worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in truth. He goes on. So, like I said, so I'm reading and I want to know, okay, what is all this telling me about God? Well, there's a lot in there about life and life that continues to flow. But there's a pretty interesting conversation in here because the Samaritans are very committed to their temple and the Jews are very committed to their temple. Temple worship has been extremely important. It's very elaborate and there's very specific ways that all this takes place. We get all that, right? But it's interesting in that he said there's a time coming, and that time is where we live. He said there's a time coming when you don't worship in Jerusalem or you don't worship where your temple is. There's not a place of worship. So again, as I'm reading and I want to know about God, I want to know God, all right, and then God, what I'm hearing here is there's no place that I need to go to worship you. So, all right, so what is important? Now, I want us to go on a little trip. And boy, we don't have, I know I'm watching the clock. We'll try to get there in the right time. But we need to understand something that is just happens. It happens in the world, all right? If you pay much attention, and some of you do, and some of you all you also like history, do you realize over in the Middle East, there's a lot of problems? Y'all know that? All right, and there's one area where there's really a lot of problems, and it's not Afghanistan necessarily. There's problems there. It's not Iraq. There's problems there. But where we really have world-impacting problems is in that little small area just east of the Mediterranean in a place called Palestine. And in a place called Palestine, there's a little bitty area that is called Israel, is referred to as Israel. And this is really significant because this is where the Jewish people are. Y'all know this from your own study of everything, but you know, God brought his people when he had Abraham start the journey. He brought his people to where? To this area that I'm talking about, right? He brought them there and he blessed them there. And they had a temple there, and it was there that they worshiped their God. And today, there is a significant population that still attempts to worship their God in Jerusalem just like they did in the time that Jesus is talking, all right? There's another group of people that want to worship their God in that same place. You see, this Jewish people that now are in this area to some degree and to some level of protection, they still try to live out the commands of the Old Testament that we talk about, some 600 and something commands that, you know what, if you're a Jew, many of those commands cannot be kept anywhere in the world, any physical place in the world other than Jerusalem. It's very important. Had you been raised, and if you were a follower of that, and you maintain that to this day, that homeland would be extremely important to you. There's this other population of the Muslims that view Jerusalem just as significant. Did you know they view that if you do one good act in your life anywhere in the world, that's considered one good act, but if you do one good deed in Jerusalem, in that place, that act is worth 1,000 more times credit to their Father than it is if it's done anywhere else in the world, no different than if they do one wrong thing, it has 1,000 times the gravity of the wrong. That's how significant that homeland is to them, right? Now, I share that with you because our great leaders, in their wisdom, think what we need to do is have peace among these two. And the way we'll do that is we'll give each of them some part of land and we'll let Jerusalem be a co-capital for them. Now, how do you think that's going to work out? Now, I'm not some political scholar and I'm not trying to make some political statement, but I'm going to tell you, these people because of their deep-rooted background in the religion that they follow. They are never going to be at peace with each other. They can't be at peace with each other. That is not allowed. All right? Now, I don't mean that they as a country might figure something out, but all right. So I'm telling y'all that. Is so, really, after AD 70 and the Jewish temple was destroyed, the Jews were scattered. And for thousands of years, they've been scattered. But then they started wanting to, and there was like in the late 1800s, it's called Zionism, but they wanted to come back and they wanted their state. They wanted to be recognized by the world as a country, not just a religious sect, but they wanted their homeland back. They believed God gave them that land, and they should still have that land, and they should be a country recognized, all right? Guess what? That section is all a part of, or was a part of, the Ottoman Empire, of which were many growing population of Muslims that have, they had moved into this area, all right, and they inhabited much of what is today Palestine. We can't get into a deep history lesson, but if you like history, you know during World War I, when you had Britain and France and Russia, you know, they were trying to do battle in World War I, and they were trying to figure out how to win. Things weren't working out so well for them, and the U.S. really hadn't gotten too involved, and all of a sudden, they wanted to get the United States involved, and they figured out the way we can change the political sort of posture of the United States is get the Jewish part. Now, here's what you got to get, is when we talk about the Jewish people moved them, they considered themselves Jews first, not Americans, not British, not French, and I don't mean that as a negative thing. They are a Jew, and they will always be a Jew, and that is where their loyalty lies. So they knew if we could get sort of this Jewish population to put some energy and maybe pressure on the United States, they would get involved in the war. Now, why? Okay, we got to, I love history, y'all know that, but we got to move on from this to see the significance. Here's what happened. And you can find it in the Declaration of Balfour, but what happened is these countries that wanted to use the Jews to their advantage, no different than the countries that wanted to use the part of the Muslims to their advantage that were breaking away from this Ottoman Empire as it's sort of falling apart, they promised both of them the same thing, Jerusalem, basically. They promised them both their own state. Well, guess what? When it ends up, you can't make that happen. You know, we've been trying to, but there has been loyalty in a lot of ways to Israel and to the Jewish state. That's why you do have Israel now. But you just, I tell you all that there's still Israel trying to maintain its part of the state, and people are trying to figure out how to have peace with Palestine and all that. Okay, what does all that have to do with anything? That's sort of a mess. And why it is sort of a mess? Well, there's two reasons. One, God said a long time ago to Isaac and Ishmael that you'll always be at battle with each other, so it's always just going to sort of be a mess, all right? That's one problem. But the other problem is you've got people that have a deep-rooted desire for something, and you have people promising them, if you do this, if you follow this, if you'll this, whatever, you'll get that. And it's not really possible for the people making the promises to follow through on that. You say, what in the world has that got to do with anything that we're talking about? Well, here it is, folks. I'm going to give you just a couple of things. John chapter 4, verse 24, in this whole statement, it said, God is spirit and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in the truth. And I'm going to share another verse with you in a minute. For our lifetime, and not just our lifetime, ever since Jesus left and people have been trying to figure it out, there have been people that want to use your desire to serve God to their advantage. All right? And humankind that understands God, they want to please God. So people have set up systems by which they say, if you follow this, follow that, whatever that might be, that in doing this, you will find God, and then you will be pleasing to God, and you'll have peace and joy. You have all this, right? The problem is, that's not what God said. You see, so just as the Jews and the Palestinians have been misled by so many countries and so many governments, and they pretty much have misled them because of their intent to use them as a people to their advantage, so has, and I'm going to put it this way, the religious system used people to their advantage because of the religious system's advantage because of the people's desire to please and serve God. So, you get, all right, you want to serve God, right? And I'm just throwing up a couple of verses, and you can take this or you can go wherever you need to go with it. But we have taken this verse and said, if you want to worship God, you must worship in truth. And what is truth? We will tell you the acts of worship that are truth, right? And I'm not only just, I'm talking about Church of Christ. You can go to the Baptist, Methodist, you can go down to your Church of the Highlands. I don't care where you go. They'll tell you what that worship looks like. And what I want us to see is God said worship is not a place. It's not an act. Worship doesn't look like anything. All right? The woman said, I know Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. And he did. He explained everything to us. And he said the place of worship has no bearing whatsoever on the act of worship. It's important. The place of worship has no bearing whatsoever on the act of worship. Now, I always feel like I have to say qualifiers. Okay, what we're doing now, is this good? It is great when groups of people get together and want to share together. They want to teach together. They want to fellowship together. That is wonderful. But what I'm telling you is worship, your worship of God has nothing to do with where you are. And that's a wonderful thing. In fact, I think that was a true part of the significance of God destroying the temple. Because he wanted people to get the picture, okay? I'm not in the temple anymore. Well, wait a minute. He is in the temple, all right? And we'll see that in a minute. But I want you, here's what really John chapter 4, verse 24 means. It means God is spirit, all right? We get that. God is spirit. And his worshipers must sing, rejoice, and minister and pray in the Holy Ghost. And in what is true in things appertaining to God. You know, oh my goodness, what in the world does all that mean? All right, and we're going to see it in just a minute. That means worship's in here. Right? Worship is in here. Now, it may reflect itself in your life in singing. It may reflect itself in your life in rejoicing with God in some way. It may reflect itself in you cutting your neighbor's grass. I don't know how it might reflect itself in all kinds of ways, but the worship is in here. Acts chapter 7, verse 48 says, however, the Most High does not live in houses made by human hands. Right? So, I'm wanting this to be encouraging. And I told you, I'm going to give you an assignment in a minute. It's not really an assignment, but I want to help enlighten us in an area that is so important for our everyday life. All right? We used to, and I'm hoping we won't do this anymore, we used to call these places of worship, right? They're not. They're buildings that facilitate a variety of things, and that's all fine. But your place of worship is in here. This is where you commune with God. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19, Paul said, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? We know this. The temple is where they went to see and to meet with God in the holiest of holies. And now where do you meet God in the holiest of holies? Right here. So, you know, from the old days in the old white building to the new day and the, you know, more of a concert type environment and atmosphere, what we have always been attempting to create and to facilitate is an experience with God. And many people have experienced God in the little white church building, or they experience God in more of the, you know, whatever the environment is that they're in. And I'm not saying that doesn't happen. That happens, all right? But my point is, You don't have to have that to have the worship experience with God. In fact, I find more often than not, and I didn't realize it, that is more distracting to my experience with God than it is me really experiencing God. Here's what I mean. So when I'm at the beach, I read a book to keep my mind from realizing how bored I really am. You just sit in the beach in a chair for like 8 hours. That's sort of boring, right? So I read a book, and what does that do? For me, that distracts my mind from thoughts I don't want to have, right? What we typically do a lot of times when we come together, and I'm not, again, this isn't a bad thing, all right? But we will sing, and that's wonderful. We'll have prayer, we'll commune. And what we are doing is we are taking distractors that are typically carnal and we're turning them into spiritual distractors. All right? I just want you to follow what I'm saying. Because it's still taking and occupying my mind, but it's occupying my mind on something that's more positive than where my mind spends a lot of time on something that's rather negative. You know, thoughts of the world. And when I say regular negative, thoughts of the world, work tomorrow, and, you know, who I wasn't happy with last week and who I might need to have a conversation with, you know, all those things. So now I put them on and I do this. I got to think about it. This is what I do when I listen to music. I really take, and I am still in my mind distracted, but I'm distracted in good things rather than frustrating things, right? I want to share one of the verses with you, and I want to tie this up. So we go to this verse, Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. We've used this verse typically. When I say we, the religious system. And when I'm, you know, you get what I'm saying. Again, not system-wide has used this verse to conform people into the thought that you have to come to the building whenever there's a meeting of the people together because you can't forsake the meeting of people together, right? Y'all, I know something, this makes you uncomfortable, but it's the truth. We have beat this sort of into people that you have to show up when something happens. If you're not, you're not pleasing to God, all right? And I don't think in any way God sent the pandemic to us for a particular purpose, but it came, and guess what it taught us? Oh, wow, all of a sudden we can have church and not go to the building, right? Have you ever wondered how that would have been sinful 4-3 years ago, but when you have a disease now, it's not sinful? There's something contradictory in that. We don't like to hear that. You don't want to hear it. I don't really want to hear it. But there is something contradictory in the fact that you have to come together to worship, but then all of a sudden, when people might get sick if we get together, we don't. Just for thought. Now, here's why I really brought this verse up. I did a tremendous amount of research yesterday, having looked at something to find out what in the world does meeting together mean. And I'm going to share this thought with you. And I'm going to give you what I hope will be encouragement. We can't go into the depth of what this means. But if you go look, go do your own study. Go look up the Greek word and try to find explanations of the Greek word and take it. All right, here's what it means. It means you in your spirit and God in His spirit meeting together in the holiest of holies, meeting together in His temple, meeting together in His place, of you being with Him. And where is that? It's here. He's saying, I don't want you to forsake getting together with Me. Because guess what? When you get together with Me, that will spur you on to everything I desire for you in your life. But in order for that to happen, and all that we've talked about in worship, and all that this day is about, please take it. It is all about this one experience that I had for a short period of time this week. I have had a number of times in my life, but I recognize and acknowledge, and this is my encouragement to you, I do not commit enough time to this one thing. I shared it at Hirshwood Small Group. And what is that? Go where Jesus went. You want to know about God? You want to know God? Then you need to spend time with God just like Jesus did. When Jesus wanted to spend time with God, where did he go? He went to a quiet place. Doesn't mean you can't have an experience with God here, but this ain't a quiet place. I enjoy thinking about God when I'm on the treadmill with the earphones and some good music that I like to, but that's not a quiet place. Please hear me, folks. This is so important. You worship God when you can get your mind to that place that it's only you and God. Nothing else. Nothing else. Cody Carnes sings a song and it's titled that, Nothing Else. But you have to go there. You have to go there. And what I want to leave you with, folks, is that will bring into your life the most joyous, grace-filled, loving, compassionate, every possible pretty word you want to put there. In that moment when you're there and there is nothing else, that is what you will be. You will be that. And when you are that, for just a short period of time, you will want to be that more. And the more you're that, the more you're God-like. That's my invitation to you today. Father, we love you so much. We thank you for everything you tell us about you. We thank you, Father, for your desire to be in our heart, to be in our mind. Father, help us to step inside ourselves and to experience you. Through Jesus we pray. Amen.
We ask the parents of small children to go pick them up from class. We're going to sing in just a minute, and then we'll be dismissed. We encourage you to stay for lunch and have some fellowship time together. Let's sing and stand.
A common love for each other, a common gift to the Savior, a common bond holding us to the Lord, a common strength when we're weary, a common hope for tomorrow, a common joy in the truth of God's word.
You are dismissed.